Welcome, dear learners. I am Dr. Sanjana Vich from Amity University, Haryana. Today, I am going to take up the topic that is group-centered approaches. As we all know that there is a shift from teacher-centered to learner-centered, and when we talk about learner-centered, group activities are the most important thing. So let's start with the group-centered activities. What is an activity? As per the picture, you all can see this picture, and in this picture we all can see that people are sitting in a group or working in a group. This is what group activity is. It enables students to discover deeper meaning in the content and improving thinking skills. Group work or group activity is a group way of students to learn from one another and to build a sense of community in the classroom. In fact, group work can be effective method to motivate students, encourage active learning and develop key critical thinking, communication and decision making skills. When we talk about activity based approach, importance is given to the learner who gets new knowledge by doing this activity in his or her own environment. In group activities, need, interest and mental ability and social context of the learner is most important. The most effective use of group activity is that which engages students with higher level content and is thought-provoking, difficult to understand or has multiple interpretations. Now, what could be the elements for an effective learning? Activities are engaging and encouraging students to achieve the learning objectives. However, activities should not be hard or too easy for the students. Few points as a teacher we need to keep in our mind when we are using this particular technique. First one is focused. Activity for learning is always goal directed and so designed in such a way that all the students can participate and should focus to solve the problems or to reach the target and not easily distracted. The second point is challenging. An effective activity poses a challenge before the students. It is neither too easy nor neglect nor too difficult to attempt for solving. It is moderately difficult, which is within the capacity of the student to solve, but with concentration or with little more effort. Spontaneous involvement. A good activity is such that attracts the students immediately when it starts and they join in it out of their own interest without any compulsion. Joyful. The test of the efficiency of the activity is when the student derives a sense of satisfaction after his completion. The very nature of the good activity is that is entrusting the students to conclude, and it brings a sense of achievement, provides joy, which ultimately becomes the source of motivation for the students to go for the next activity, which might be more challenging. There are many group activities in teaching learning process which are helpful for achieving teaching learning objectives. We are going to learn one by one. The first which I am going to talk about is brainstorming. In the field of education, brainstorming is a large or a small group of activities that encourage the students to focus on a topic and contribute his free flow of ideas. These ideas are listed exactly as they are expressed in a board or a flip chart or written on a bit of paper. These generated ideas usually leads to a very animated and energizing sessions. Even the more reserved participants should feel bold enough to contribute. The purpose of listening responses is to collect existing experiences and thoughts. It is useful for collect answers to questions when you expect much repetition in the responses. After a brainstorming session, the ideas can be discussed further and evaluated. For example, listing the best opinions in a systematic way, ideas can be grouped and analyzed so that they belong to a group rather than individual. There are few purposes of brainstorming: to focus students' attention on a particular topic, to generate particular ideas, to teach acceptance and respect for individual differences, to encourage the learner to take a risk in sharing their ideas and opinions, to demonstrate to the students that their knowledge and abilities are valued and accepted, to provide an opportunities for students to share ideas and expand their knowledge by building one others. There are few characteristics of brainstorming, like it is an activity which maximize or all students can participate. Each student gives their personal viewpoints or ideas. Each idea is neither right or wrong. It involves divergent thinking. It involves participant and ownership of the idea, and it also encourages creativity. Next is cooperative learning. This is a specific small group approach that incorporates democratic process, individual accountability, equal opportunity, and group rewards. Cooperative learning involves small heterogeneous students group working together to solve a problem or complete a task. All students in group must actively participate, with each students maintaining some interdependence. The success of the group depends on the input of each individual. Thus, teaching method promotes active participation, individual accountability, students' ability to work cooperatively, and improvement of social skills. Basically, the cooperative learning model was developed to achieve at least three important instructional goals. The first one is academic achievement, the second one is acceptance of diversity, and the third one is social skill development. Now, there are few key features of cooperative learning. Students work in group to master academic material. Groups are heterogeneous, consisting of high average or low achievers. Wherever possible, teams include a mix of racial, culture, and gender of students. Reward systems are group-centered rather than individual-centered or individual-oriented. In the cooperative learning approach, the authority remains with the teacher, who retains ownership of the risk, and she continuously monitors, guides, and suggests few modifications to keep the group on the track of solving the problem. According to Brown and Kufitin Parker in 2009, five essential elements of cooperative learning are: the first one is positive interdependence. It means that students must fully participate and put effort within their group. Each group member has a task responsibility. Therefore, they must believe that they are responsible for their own learning and that of their group. Promoting face-to-face interaction, in which members promote each other's success. Students explain to one another what they have or learning and assist others with understanding and completion of assignments. Next is individual accountability. Each student demonstrates masters of the content being studied. Each student is accountable for their learning and work. Next, social skills. Social skills are also very necessary for a successful cooperative learner to occur. Social skill includes effective communication, interpersonal and group skills like leadership, decision making, trust building, communication and conflict management skills. Next is group processing. Every group must assess their effectiveness and decide how it can be improved. When designing cooperative learning tasks and reward structures, individual responsibility and accountability must be identified. Individual must know exactly what their responsibility are and what they are accountable to the group in order to reach their goal. Positive interdependence among student in the group for the task should there and it should be visible for effective learning. All group members must be involved in a group to complete the task. For this to occur, each member must have a task that they are responsible for, which cannot be complied by other or any other group member. Cooperative learner is an effective teaching strategy educators use to help improve their students' understanding of the subject. The teacher role is the most important one of them. In order to make cooperative learning successful, the teacher must serve as a facilitator, referee, observer, and evaluator. Few guidelines a teacher need to learn in the cooperative learning process is arrangement the sitting. Arrangement the chairs and desk in such a manner they all are sitting in a small clusters. This make them easier for group to discussion with to have a discussion with each other, and they will be able to work together in a better manner. Select the groups. Depending upon the task and the class size, it is generally recommended for groups to be as small as 2 or as large as 6. In smaller groups, each member gets to wear many hats, participate more, and get the work done and much quicker. While in larger groups, students tend to generate a lot of ideas, but many find it harder to manage such a large group. The most effective and successful group size tends to be 3 to 4 group members because they take less time to complete a task. Experiment with different group sizes and see what works best for their classrooms. Assign students. Assign each student to a group. Research favors heterogeneous groups because the difference among the members help the group functions, increase self-esteem, and produces the opportunities for peer support. Provide materials. When choosing materials, keep in mind what each student's role will be in the group. Depending upon the task, students can have the same material or each student can have different material. State expectations. Before you give the students their task, make sure you state what your expectations are for the assignment. Be clear and make sure you provide specific examples and model appropriate behavior. Structure individual roles. It is your job to assign each group members a specific role. Very, very important thing for a teacher. She has to assign a proper job to each and every member of the group. Have a task leader, observer, timekeeper, material manager, researcher, recorder, fact checker, discussion leader, etc. This will ensure that each group member is responsible for their own role in the group in addition to the whole group task. Monitor and circulate. Be sure to circulate around the room and monitor and check for understanding. Make it clear that each student is responsible and accountable for their group. To help you get an insight on students' understanding, assign one member in each group as a role of observer. Have the student mark down the data of how well their group understands the concept and how well they worked together. Intervene to answer questions and teach skills. There will come a time when individual from each group will have a question. Use this time to play the role to consult and have the group help answer to questions. Teach them the skills they need to be able to solve their problems and get their task completed. Evaluate results. Evaluate each student based upon how well they learned the material. If they completed the task, and how well they help this group. Remember that each student receives the same grade as their group. Remember, as a teacher, our main role is to keep the student in each group actively participating. Make sure you walk around the room and constantly monitor the student's progress. Give the students feedback and teach them the skills they need for their groups to be a success. Cooperative learning increases self-esteem and self-concept of the learners. Cooperative learning encourages a number of social benefits. By working together, students learn more effective communication and interpersonal skills. They learn to listen to each other and to resolve conflicts. Collaborative in this way brings them together as a class, leading to overall better social relation and acceptance among the group. Each member has opportunities to contribute in a small groups. Students take more ownership of their material and think critically about related issues when they work as a team. Differences among learners arises out of gender, social category, and physically and mentally challenged barriers are broken down, allowing for positive interaction and friendship to occur. Next is group discussion. Group discussion involves two-way communication between participants. In the classroom situation, an instructor and students all participate in discussion. During discussion, the instructor spends some time listening while the students spend some time talking. The discussion is therefore a more active learning experience for the student than the lecture. The preparation and conduct of group discussion method are orientation, engagement, and debriefing. The first one is orientation. The teacher provides the discussion topic. She clearly describes the question, explains how students have to prepare for discussion, explain how the discussion will be concluded, and encourage the students to think. In engagement, the teacher should develop an environment and present clear questions to focus the discussion. Start by asking students to define the terms and, if necessary, help the students. Wait for each student to answer the question. Keep a progressive record and close discussion by summarizing or evaluating. The third point is debrief, which is also a very, very important point, which states always debrief students. It is the most important part of the discussion, the time to summarize and synthesize. Most of the learning in discussion happens during debriefing. So don't squeeze it. A thumb rule for that is use 1/3 of the total discussion time for debriefing. There are a few advantages of group discussions. For example, the first one is emphasize on learning instead of teaching. Discussion method emphasizes pupil activity in the form of discussion rather than simply telling and lecturing by the teacher. Thus, this method is more effective if we compare with other lecture methods. Participation by everybody. In this method, everybody participates in the discussion and therefore thinks and express himself. This is sure way of learning. Development of democratic way of thinking. Everybody cooperates in the discussion and the idea of opinions of everybody are respected. Thus, there is a development of democratic way of thinking and arriving at the decision. Training in reflective thinking. Students during the course of discussion get training in reflective thinking, which leads to deeper understanding of the historical problem under discussion. Training in self-expression. During discussion, everybody is required to express this idea and opinion in a clear and concise manner. This provides ample opportunities to the students for training in self-expression. Spirit of tolerance is included. The students learn to discuss and differ with other members of the group. They learn to tolerate the views of others even if they are unpleasant and contradictory to each other's view. Thus, respect for the viewers or the viewpoint of others is developed. Learning is made interesting. History is considered to be a dry subject. The learning of history is made interesting through discussion method. More effective learning is possible when the student discuss, criticize, and share ideas on a particular problem. Active participation by the student in the discussion makes learning full of interest for the students. This also ensures better and effective learning. Now, what are the challenges of group discussions? All types of topic cannot be taught by group discussion method. The students may not follow the rules of discussion. Students who do not contribute. Students who contribute more than appropriate. Students who fail to respect the discussion and their peers. Students who are unprepared. So all these are the few challenges which teacher might face during group discussions. But in spite of these limitations, discussion method is very useful and effective method for the teaching. And let's have a quick recap. Today we have talked about group-centered activities, group-centered approaches, in which we have talked about brainstorming session, that how it is going to be useful for the teachers as well as for the students. We have also talked about their advantages and disadvantages. After that, we have discussed about cooperative learning, what is the role of the teachers in cooperative learning along with its advantages and disadvantages. We have also discussed about group discussions, what are the challenges the teacher faced during group discussions, and what are the advantages and disadvantages. I hope this lesson is going to be useful for you. Thank you. All the best.